Okay, so it's my pleasure to introduce Rally Mehdia. I shall talk about applications of computer algebra for identifiability and diagnosability.
Thank you. I would first thanks Gleb for his invitation. So I will make an overview of a part of my research because I'm working on lots of subjects. So today I will talk about the identifiability and diagnosability study. The adventure begins during my thesis, in which I must study a pharmacokinetic model. It consists in studying if the macrophage, which are the first defensor of the body, can be carrier of antibiotics. So for this model, we need to study the identifiability of the proposed model and to make the estimation of the parameters. So why the identifiability of the model? Because when a model is identifiable, when you have some measurements, you are unsure that it corresponds one parameter vector of your model. So during a project in France, I worked on fault diagnosability and fault diagnosis. So consider that you have a navigation system and you must conceive it. So to see if there are some malfunctions in your system, you put some sensors in your system. Now, consider that you have a mathematical model that can well describe the behaviors of your physical system. And the question that arises is if from your mathematical model, it is possible to discriminate the faults that can occur in your physical system. So it is the fault diagnosability. And once you have a system that ensures you that you can discriminate the faults that can occur in your system, you can put in place some numerical method in order to detect and isolate these faults.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
So you infect the cell.
Yes.
And then injection of macromolecules. What's the relation between the macromolecules and the cells?
The macromolecule will be the antibiotic, which is that the macrophage will carry towards the infected cells. So we have two processes. The first one is the absorption of the antibiotic by the macromolecule, and then the macromolecule by the macrophage. So you have two types because you cannot inject directly the antibiotic in the macrophage. You need a macromolecule to do that. So in this project with Karine Gioberti and Luis Trabamassouyes, we worked on uncertain system with bounded error. That is, when you have a physical system, you have some perturbations, some noises on your measurements, and either you know the noises and you can use stochastics tools, or if you don't know the noises, you can use interval analysis. So the idea is to have a lower and upper trajectories of your measurements and to work with interval analysis. And then I work on identifiability, so it's submitted in a partial differential equation. The model was the transmission of the chikungunya to the human population. And we need to add a dispersion term to model the diffusion of people, which is an important which is important for the propagation of the disease. So in all these works, I use some differential algebra tools and computational algebra tools. And here today, I will talk more particularly about identifiability, phosphodiagnosability, and phosphodiagnosis on ordinary differential equation system. So let's see the systems that I consider. So they are classical. They are composed of differential equation in which x is a state variable describing the evolution in time of a process. This evolution depends on a parameter vector p, an input of your system or a control. And on this system, you have the possibility to have some measurements, so some state variables that you can measure from your physical system. So here we have f and h, which we are supposed analytic, but it is not restrictive. And so y is the output of our model. When you have these systems, you see this system, you have two problems that can be considered. The classical one is a forward problem that is from p, the parameter vector p on the input, you want to find the solution x and y. You have another problem which is more difficult, it is the inverse problem. So given y and u, you want to estimate the parameter vector. This problem is decomposed into two sub-problems. You have first the identifiability problem. So the question is, from your measurements or the outputs of the model, is it possible to estimate uniquely your parameter vector? So it is a theoretical work that is done because we suppose that the measurements are perfect, there are no noise on your measurements. Then comes the question of the identification problem, which is in general a very imposed problem because a little change in your measurements can make a big difference, a big change in your estimation of parameter vectors. A simple example is the differentiation and the integration, which are two inverse problems of each other. And in fact, it is the integration which is the direct problem, and the derivation, which is an inverse problem. It is very imposed. It can be proved that if you have a little perturbation on your measurements, the estimation of derivatives can be very, very bad. So the methods that I would propose afterwards to study the identifiability of the model 1 is based on the Rosenfeld-Gruner algorithm, which was implemented by François Boulier in Maple. And what is the definition of identifiability? In general, in the first definitions of identifiability, the initial conditions were not considered. So you have a set of trajectories, a set of solutions. That is why I note y bar for the set of solutions. So the model is said globally identifiable. Okay. Yes?
Could you clarify? So y bar of TP is the set of all solutions that corresponds to the parameter value p and all possible initial
conditions. Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yes. Thank you.
So the model is said globally identifiable. If there exists an input, a control, so that for all parameter vector p, the set of trajectories generated by p is not an empty set, first. And then if it has an intersection with the set of outputs generated by p bar, if this intersection is not an empty set, so there is a common trajectory, then necessarily the parameter vectors are equal. In other words, if you have two parameter vectors that are different, the set of trajectories will have no common trajectories. Yes. It's okay for this definition. So no, in fact, I compare two tubes of trajectory, and if the parameter vectors are different, these two tubes of trajectory will not intersect. So you can propose a local definition too. In most cases, you don't need to consider all the parameters in R for example. So you can restrict the definition set of parameters. Now, when you have initial condition, your system has only one solution, one trajectory. So we say that the model is globally identifiable if there exists an input U, such that if you have two trajectories that coincide on a time interval, then they are generated by the same parameter vector. In other words, if you have two parameter vectors different, so the trajectories will not coincide on a time interval. We can propose too a local identifiable definition, so if needed. And I will explain the methods that I use on this pharmacokinetic model. So here it is the absorption of the macro of the antibiotic by the macromolecule. In fact, we use glucose oxidase for studying this model because it is easier to see in the experiments. So the first equation describes the concentration of glucose oxidase outside the cell. And K12 is absorption by the cell of the macromolecule by the glucose oxidase. X2 is the evolution of glucose oxidase inside the macromolecule. And we suppose that we can observe the glucose oxidase outside the cell. So we set y equal to x1. Now I use the Rosenfeld-Grundner algorithm with elimination order, which consists in eliminating the state variable x1, x2 in favor of the output y. So the Rosenfeld-Grundner algorithm provides a set of regular chains, and in particular, a particular chain is a general case, so it is what I consider. In this set, we have a particular polynomial that link only the input, and the parameters of the system. So it is the first equation, and then you have equations that link the state variable that we don't observe in favor of the output of your system. So let's take the first equation and factorize it so that we have a term not depending on the parameters and plus linear combination of block of parameters. So in gray, you have there is no parameters, and in gamma, so the block of parameters are gamma 1, gamma 2, and gamma 3. Now let's take the definition of identifiability. I suppose that you have two trajectories that coincide. The first one that is generated by P, and the other by P bar. Evaluate this input-output polynomial in P and P bar, and make the difference. So the difference is equal to zero, but we eliminate the gray terms in which there is no parameters. So when we see this polynomial, if the term in blue are linearly independent, so we have the difference gamma kp minus gamma kp bar, which are equal to zero. So the first thing is to verify that the term in blue are linearly independent. So we evaluate the functional determinant.
What do you mean determinant here?
The functional determinant. So you form it, you take
the
term. Yes, the Roskan.
Okay, thank you. And could you also explain, how do you know that this is non-zero? I mean, this...
By mapper.
But like, you know this is non-zero
for
Y is a solution of the system?
Yes, it's generic. So it is sufficient to find one time in which the functional determinant is not equal to zero. So if you're
so you just plug some initial values,
yes,
some
yes,
parameter,
you test,
and
yes.
If you find this non-zero, then
yes,
I see.
Yes,
so
yes.
And do you actually do it like this? So you actually plug some numbers and see whether it's zero.
Yes,
or not.
It is sufficient.
Yes. Okay.
So now I can keep the coefficients of this difference, and I must add an algebraic system. So, when to have the identifiability of your model, it is sufficient to solve gamma p minus gamma p bar equal to zero. And here, in that case, you can use, for example, Grubner algorithm implemented in Maple. We prove that p is equal to p bar, so the model is identifiable.
May I ask one more question about this determinant? Have you ever seen a model where this determinant would be zero?
Yes, it is possible. But in fact, in general, it provides from a bad factorization of your polynomial P, what I see in the example. The theory makes So it has been proved that with this sort of system, if you have, for example, m observation, m outputs, you have m input-output polynomial. So for simplification, here I suppose that I have one observation, so I have only one input-output polynomial. This input-output polynomial can take the following general form, so a term not depending on the parameter vector, plus a linear combination of a block of parameters. These block of parameters are called the exhaustive summary, and Lilian Denis Vidal proves that if the terms in blue are linearly independent, then to prove that the model is globally identifiable, it is sufficient to solve the system gamma k p bar equal to gamma k p, and to prove that p is equal to p bar.
May I ask about this proposition? Yes. So this proposition is like if, it's not if and only if.
Yes, it's an implication.
It's an implication, okay,
yes,
thank
yes.
you.
Mm-hmm. But there is a version with an equivalence when you have initial condition.
I see, mm-hmm. Thank you.
So, in fact, 3 can be considered in another way. You can construct the function phi, which to a parameter vector p associates a block of parameters. And so 3 consists in verifying that phi is injective. In fact, it has produced lots of results, the studying of this injectivity of phi. So, for example, it provides a strategy to reparametrize unidentifiable ODE models into identifiable ones. So, for example, they use the Gromner bases to find identifiable combinations and to reparametrize the model. You can to this two diagram provides to the strategy to determine the key parameters to estimate in order to obtain the identifiability of some important biological parameters. This work is based too on algebraic computers. So it is based on an equivalence between a generalization of the identifiability definition and the existence of solution of an algebraic system. And then the use of symbolic computation in testing their existence. Another interesting application is that it can permit to determine the protocol to estimate parameters when there are lots of parameters in a system. For example, there is an interesting example on a neuronal model in a service. So let's come to the Wronskians, the functional determinant. So I recall that to estimate this functional determinant, for example, the functional determinant of the function phi 1, phi s, you derivate sufficiently this function to have a square system, and you calculate this determinant. So it is sufficient to have one time, so that this functional determinant is not equal to zero. This method is very interesting because it is possible to have a first estimation of your parameters without any knowledge of them. So imagine that you have your measurements in this real time. So you can evaluate your input-output polynomial in this polynomial. So I omit y and u for simplification. So for example, you have you form this system. Which is linear in the block of parameters, so you can rewrite it in the following form, where gamma is a part in the vector gamma 1 plus and gamma. So it is, in general, a rectangular system that you can solve in using the factor the QR factorization.
How do you compute the derivatives? You just estimate them as differences? The derivatives that are inside these MIs?
Yes.
They are estimated as differences or?
No. You could use, for example, the base spin, which
work.
It's a good method, I think.
Can you see on the previous slide?
Yes.
Previous.
Yeah, I think she means the previous year.
Is this?
Before.
Before.
Before. Earlier. Now I'm just trying to see where your P. What's this system? P.
P is a vector K12, K21, and K.
So this red K is. Where k is, they can constitute the vector p.
I see. Small p, that's
yes, correct. Yeah, yes. Small p is a vector of three coordinates, k12, k21, and k.
And capital P is this difference.
What do you see? Capital p is, yes, is a polynomial.
Polynomial.
It doesn't have anything to do with small p.
Okay.
They are just.
Okay.
No, I will present you two papers on the diagnosability study. And there is a strong link with the identifiability notion. So in general, a fault is an unpermitted deviation of at least one parameter of the system from the acceptable standard condition. So finally, your physical system will not have the good behavior that you expect. Then the fault diagnosability establishes which fault can be discriminated using the available sensor in a system. It is a general study that you do before the conception of your physical system. And then, if the fault diagnosability is verified, you have the fault diagnosability. The fault diagnosis, which consists to put in place a method to do fault detection of the malfunction of a system and the fault isolation of the faulty component. So for this study, I use lots of tools in algebra. But let's see first the type of model on which I work. So it is similar from the previous one. Except that we have a vector of fault that can impact the parameters of your system, the input of your system, or the output. So you can add initial condition too. And in this case, in this work, we suppose that F is the parameter vector. So when f is equal to zero, it means that you have no fault, and you can consider too that the model is uncontrolled, so you can put u equal to zero. Let's see this simple example, the Bernoulli equation. It's a first order equation in which you have two parameters, beta 1 and beta 2. Suppose now that a fault F1 impacts additively the parameter beta 1, F2 impacts additively the parameter beta 2. And so you can rewrite your equation. But now I want to work with input of two polynomials because they have very nice properties. So if I rewrite my Bernoulli equation like that, finally, I add if I observe one, I have my input output polynomial. So it's very simple case. Now if you have a fault, it will be like that. So here it is your input output polynomial, and if you have no fault, this input, the value of your input output polynomial is equal to zero by definition. But if you evaluate this input output polynomial with a fault, finally you will have, imagine that your fault occurs in your system, this relation is not verified, so this input polynomial is not equal to zero. So the difference comes from the term here. So I can rewrite my differential equation. The difference comes from this term. So in fact, the input output polynomial of the system with a fault, I will call it omega. So
of your polynomial, but afterwards I will write it on a gazebo. And you add a this additive term that I call omega 1. So finally, it can constitute a signature that is an equation that can say me that there is a fault in my system. So what I want to say is that this part is called so the residual computation form, because if you have your measurements in of your system, you can estimate, you can evaluate it in each time of your measurement. But here it is an internal form.
In this case, do you assume that we do know beta 1 and beta 2?
Yes.
I see. That's why we can agree with this. I see. Mm-hmm.
So here it is a residual internal form. And internal because since I don't know the fault, the value of the fault, I cannot estimate them directly. So this part will form a signature, so I can show you the following of my slide. So your input-output polynomial of your system with a fault can be decomposed in two parts. The first part, it is the input-output polynomial with no fault, and the second part, it's the expression depending only on the fault. So classically, what it was done is that when you have a relation, a differential relation, an algebraic relation, you form a vector to define a signature, and if your fault appears in the relation, you put 1, and it doesn't appear in your relation, you put 0. So here, we have only one relation. The two faults appear in my input-output polynomial, so the classical signature is equal to 1 for the two faults. All right. So I haven't any information about the faults, so it wasn't interesting for us. So what we propose is to form a functional signature, since it depends on the function y, and it is the second part of the polynomial. So the functional signature of f1, for example, is constructed from omega 1 with f2 equal to 0. So you have only f1 times y. Yeah. And then, if you want the functional signature of f2, you take omega 1 and you put f1 equal to 0, so you have f2 times y squared. So, in fact, our functional signature consists in trajectories, and I would like that they are different to discriminate my faults. So, if my two trajectories are different, distinct on a time interval, we will say that the faults are discriminable on the model, since it's diagnosable, since we have only two faults. Diagnosable if the property must be verified for all the faults in the system. Before giving you the solution, way to prove that, I would like to show you an example, the numerical example. So imagine that you have your output that is disturbed by a Gaussian noise, so that the relative error has a maximal value to 0.1. Consider the differential polynomial formed from your system with those faults. So when there is no fault, in fact, your residual, your input-output polynomial is equal to 0. But when the fault F1 impacts the system, this polynomial is negative. But
when it is a fault F2 that occurs in the system, the polynomial is positive. So there is something behind that. So notice through this example that since we have a change of the value of my polynomial, we say that the two faults are detectable. So it's for the numerical part. Have you got any question? So let's summarize what I say. I can use, for example, the Rosenberg-Rogner algorithm for more complex example to obtain my input-output polynomials. You find the polynomials with the system in which there are some faults, and you keep the path with the faults, with the expression with the faults, and you form the signatures for each fault. So two faults will be discriminable, so here functionally discriminable, according to your question yesterday. If for all input you can find an index y star on the finite time such that the two trajectories do not coincide. The two trajectories defined by the functional signature Fg and Fl. And if this property is verified for all the faults of your system, the model is said functionally diagnosable.
So where is t plugged in? So is it for all t? Something is equal to something. So what is the...
I guess it is a function, which is a function of t.
Yes, it's a function of t, yes.
What exactly is the function of t?
The function of t is, for example, omega 1 here. So it depends on the trajectory.
The condition is only for the, I guess it's fault signature.
It's functional signature.
Function.
Yeah, but it's also a function.
Of t.
Yeah,
it's a function of t.
Yeah, because it's yeah, because if you take this W1, this W1, mm-hmm. And you like plug one of the S U depending on the I.
Ah, so T goes into Y.
Yes, T goes into Y. Yeah.
Okay.
So, as in the example, we will say that the fault is functionally detectable if there is a change in the value of the residual.
Yes.
So, how can we know easily that the two functional signatures are different? In fact, we have proved that if the model is identifiable with respect to the fault, then it is diagnosable. So, it is functionally diagnosable. So we are unsure that by proceeding like that, we can discriminate the faults that occur in the system. But the reciprocal is false. So let's see the Bernoulli equation. It is clearly identifiable with respect to the parameter to the fault vector. Since the functional determinant formed by y and y square is not identically equal to zero, and the function phi, which is construed from the coefficient of this polynomial, is injective.
Can I show the previous slide? I just want to see the definition. For that example, you would get F1 and F2?
I suppose that I have two positive faults in the system. And so I calculate the input-output polynomial with the force in the system. And finally, I can find the input-output polynomial of the initial system with those force.
So on the left, for f sig of fi, yes. You would, like if you have one f1, f2, you would do f1, comma 0.
Yes.
For the right hand side, you would do 0, comma f2.
Yes.
So these are different things, like just a different expression, right?
No, because the functional signature is defined.
F sig of the superscript of f1.
And the sig f2, they're different.
Different expressions.
Yes,
different
expressions. Yes, they're different. Uh-huh. Okay, because the definition, like the fault of fj, is.
I was reading the previous definition.
Ah,
I see. You see fj and fl. Like you're comparing
two trajectories.
But from that, it would be. Not quite a trajectory, so but it will be f1 times y, and you put in parallels of t. And this one will be f2 times y squared, mm-hmm. Right?
Do you want to see the example?
So,
is there a second item of expression?
And what exactly is this?
That's what you said, f1y, f2. Y squared.
So you're comparing that. So it's not trajectory, it's just expressions of the same trajectory, right? Two different expressions of the same trajectory. Mm-hmm. Two different algebraic expressions of the same trajectory. Is that right?
Yes, if you want, yes. Uh-huh. Yes, we take the same expression to form the two definitions. So yes, you can say that it's the same expression, but finally they're quite different.
Okay, so maybe I'll call it try to clarify it.
So the reciprocal is false. Consider the simple example of ordinary differential equation of order 1. So you have two parameters, p1 and p2, and you can find easily the solution, which is in function of an exponential, and it is positive. It's important for the tube. So consider that you have two positive and additive force that impact the parameters p1 and p2. So you obtain an equation depending only on y, the parameter p1, p2, and f1, f2. And like previously, you form the internal form omega 1. So you keep your polynomial and you keep only the expression depending on the fault. Alright, so you have only f1 minus f2 y. Is it okay? Yes. So I have no questions, so you form the functional signature of f1 and then the functional signature of f2. So you evaluate omega 1 with f2 equal to 0 to form the functional signature of f1, and you obtain f1 times an exponential here. So it is positive. Then to form the functional signature of f2, you take omega 1 and you put f1 equal to 0, and finally you find negative expression. So the two functional signatures are clearly different, distinct, so the model is diagnosable. Yes?
My question is, are f1 and f2 treated here as numbers, concrete numbers?
Yes.
So what if they're both equal to 0?
equal to zero. I suppose that I have some faults. So here I consider that F1, when I want to discriminate them, I take them not equal to zero.
So F1 and F2,
they're positive.
The
assumption.
Ah, okay. So, okay. Yes.
However, this model is not identifiable only in the thing that the function phi construct from the coefficient of the output polynomial is not injective. So the model is diagnosable but not identifiable.
Maybe let's talk about this question. But so in this case, basically, when you want to discriminate them, right? So you want to know which of them occurred.
Yes.
So and since they are both positive,
yes.
Basically, what you would like to know is what would be sufficient for you is to know the value of f1 minus f2, right? Because if you can, if f1 minus f2 is identifiable, this basically gives you which one is positive, which one is negative. Right? So could then maybe say that the divisibility is not equivalent to identifiability of both folds, but equivalent to, for example, identifiability of their difference? Because this is what you get, right? So the difference is identifiable.
Yes, yes.
Would it still not so okay, so my question would be, would diagnosability be equivalent to identifiability of the difference?
A very particular case. I think that we can find other example for which it doesn't work.
I think that it don't use that you say. Okay, we're good in the world.
Let's see when we have multifolds. The works on these subjects are very rare, but owing to the algebra tools, we have found a solution to discriminate multifolds. So let's see the example of mass, which is attached to an elastic spring. The force is K, and the displacement of this mass is described by the second ordinary differential equation that can be written in a linear differential system. And we suppose that we can have two folds, the first one on K and the second one on the input. So,
Where did this formula f1 minus 1 squared, why do you take this like this? There is some physical reasons for that? Or?
No, it's artificial.
Ah, okay, it's just for the sake of example.
Yes, yes.
I see.
Yes,
okay.
Yes.
So, what if you just wrote f1 instead and put just the range that would that f1 minus 1 squared would get? So what's the range? So the smallest is.
In fact, it is not identifiable in F1. You can have two values of F1, so 0.5 and 1.5, I think, so that you have the same behavior of your system. So the model is not identifiable with respect to the fault. So in fact, we lose the results, the previous result.
But if you rewrote it as just f1 instead of f1 minus 1 squared, would the same thing hold? If you wrote, so the reason it's not identifiable is because of the square.
Yes.
Right, so just for the artificial reason.
Yes.
But if you replace the thing just with f1,
I suppose that the faults are positive, so so if I have only f1 squared, that is
just f1 from zero.
F1, it will be identifiable.
Okay.
So,
but you wanted to illustrate something with
yes,
the square,
yes,
right?
Yes.
That's
Because in fact, since the model is not identifiable, you cannot choose the previous result. But so what we did, we propose another definition of signature. So consider, for example, the previous definition. So it is as previous. You keep the part depending only of N1 and F2. And you define the functional signature of F1, which depends only of the F1 on Y, and the functional signature of F2, which is equal to F2U. So here we can choose what we did previously. So the idea, it is as the identifiability is to die, in fact, we can obtain lots of information only in studying the coefficient of this polynomial, of the input-output polynomial. So it was the idea that we want to concretize. So we define an algebraic signature which is defined by the coefficient of this polynomial. So the exhaustive summary, yes.
Nice, but like for the fault divisibility, do you do the same as for divisibility? Namely, do you check this functional determinant?
For the identifiability?
No, so
diagnosability?
So for identifiability, what was before, before using input-output equation, we told that we have to check that the monomials are linearly independent. Uh-huh. And I'm asking whether we do this here also. Or in the divisibility we don't.
No, we don't need this property. Okay. Except if you use the previous proposition in which you need the identifiability to have your diagnosability. Okay. So. We keep the exhaustive summary, the coefficient of my input-output polynomial, and I form a vector of algebraic expression. So, the algebraic signature? The coefficient. It's only the coefficient. So now I need to define what is a multifold. So suppose that you have E4. Now form the vector of all the fields F1 and E. And to define, for example, the multifold F1 and F2. So I define, for example, the subset N, which is subset of 1 to E, for example, 1 and 2. And I will write F index N, the following vector, F1, F2, and 0 after 1. So here's index design the components that are not equal to 0. So to this functional, this multifold belongs to a semi-algebraic set here Fn. Fn is a subset of R. So R is composed of all the equalities or inequalities verified by the multifold. The vector of fault f and the set fn, so is defined in saying that a fault is in this set if fi is equal to 0 if I is not in n. So the algebraic signature is now a function which associates to vector of fault f a vector of algebraic expression admitting f1 to fe as indeterminates. So now I will work with semi-algebraic tools.
So it's a change of point of view. So the multifold of Fn and of Fn prime are said algebraic discriminable because here I work with algebraic expression. If there exists an algebraic signature, we can the expression of an algebraic signature is not unique, so that for all input u, if you look the intersection of these two sets, this intersection is an empty set. So if you have no common solution between these two semi-algebraic sets. So in fact, you have a vector when you define an algebraic signature, and it is sufficient to verify this property on one component of this algebraic signature. And if this property is verified for all the subset n, then the model is said algebraic diagnosable. Let's come back to the example of the mass. So the first step was to form the algebraic signature from the coefficients of the input-output polynomial. And you can form all the multifold vectors. So obviously, if n is empty set, you have no fault in your system. It's simply key minus d. If you have only the fault f1 here, so f2 is equal to 0. So for the second term, you have only minus d, etc. So if we compare, for example, the algebraic signature of f1 and the algebraic signature of f12, so you have the simple fault f1, and in the other case, you have the two faults f1 and f2. In fact, their intersection is an empty set, since you cannot have minus d equal to minus d minus f2. Here we suppose that the fault f2 is not equal to 0. Have you got some questions? However, we saw that the algebraic signature defined by this exhaustive summary was not sufficiently discriminant because you can have two multifolds acting on the même component of the algebraic signature, and finally you cannot discriminate them. So one idea is to find an expression of the fold in function of what we know, the parameter vector p, the value of the coefficients of the exhaustive summary. Don't forget that when I have the input-output polynomial, I can numerically estimate the block of parameters, the coefficient of this input-output polynomial. So it will be a possibility to express the multifold vector f in function of this expression. The problem it fails in general. So the idea is to propose a method to obtain other algebraic expression, but not depending on f1 and f2. Since I don't know this fault, this constant, I cannot estimate the algebraic signature actually. So the idea is to find another expression that I can compute. And for doing this, I will use algebraic tools.
Okay, as we go into that, so you had two definitions of degradability, right? So algebraic and functional.
Based
on functional solution, based on algebraic signature, are they different? Which one of them is stronger?
I think that we have more interesting results with this definition. We can extract more information on the system than it uses the functional signature, because it is always difficult to compare two trajectories. So we have the result about the identifiability, but it is
too strong for certain cases, like the previous that I showed you. So the idea is to go to find another solution. So the idea was to consider the coefficient of this input-output polynomial. So this coefficient, I recall you that they were called gamma 1, gamma q, and I can estimate them. It is on the board. So I consider this algebraic system. And so we wrote an algorithm called algebraic signature, and we uses Grodner basis computation so that we obtain a new algebraic signature, and each of its components depends only on what I can estimate, phi k, on the parameters of the system. In fact, we use the elimination order, which consists to eliminate the fault in favor of phi 1, phi q, and the parameters p.
And what are phi 1 through phi q?
It is the value of this of gamma 1, gamma q. Previously, I showed that from the experiment, the measurements that I can do on my system, I can have a numerical value of gamma 1, gamma q.
So if you know their values, then you can do this, right?
Yes.
But that's not always the case, right? That you can actually
No, because I construct my input-output polynomial in supposing to have this information, this output of my model. So I'm certain that it's good for estimation. Furthermore, by construction, each component of these two algebraic signatures vanishes when at least one specific fault occurs. So let's see the previous example. So I have the exhaustive summary, and in applying, so what I say is that phi 1 and phi 2 are known numerically, and in applying the algorithm, we find these two algebraic signatures, new algebraic expression, depending only on phi 1, phi 2, k, and d. So for example, is f2 is equal to 0, remark that, if f2 is equal to 0. So finally, phi 2 is equal to minus d. F2 is equal to 0. So I have this term. So phi 2 is equal to minus d. So in fact, there is only F1 that acts on the system, this expression is equal to 0. If it is F1 which is equal to 0, so in fact it will be the first expression of the algebraic signature which will be equal to 0, because phi1 is only k, and so it is equal to 0. So the advantage of this algebraic signature is that I can estimate it numerically. I suppose that the parameters are known. And when a fault acts, there is one of the components that is equal to 0. So it permits to discriminate easily the faults that occur in the system. So we wanted to elaborate additional criterion to improve our result. The aim was to construct a table in which we have the algebraic signature in function of the multifault, and we have, for example, 0 if the algebraic signature is always equal to 0, as previously, or not equal to 0 if the algebraic signature, the component of the algebraic signature never vanishes.
So for this, we use the semi-algebraic approach, which focuses on real solution of algebraic system. The advantage too is that it permits to take into account inequality that can define my fault vector, for example. So let's consider first the set C, the set of all algebraic equations on inequality verified by the parameter vector P on the fault vector F. Now I want to define the set depending on the index n. So it will correspond to my multifold vector f index n. So this set, which is a semi-algebraic set, is a union of C and all the algebraic expression coming from the exhaustive summary from my input-output polynomial here, and the definition of a multivector fold f index n. So for the multifold vector fn, so it is equal to zero if my index is not in n. And here it's the Rabinowitz trick, which consists to say that the fault fi is inversible. So we propose two criteria to discriminate multifold signature lying on the emptiness of semi-algebraic set. So the first thing that we verify is, are there some values of fy that so that the algebraic signature vanish or not. It's a problem. Sometimes you have some expression, but there is only one value of your fault that can annihilate your expression, and it is a problem. We want to be sure, certain of our result of the value of the algebraic signature. So we verify if the Galian component of the algebraic signature of the multifold Fn vanish or never vanishes for at least one real value of the multifold Fn. So then we want to verify if there is a fault that is equal to zero. Is it equivalent that the one of the components of the algebraic signature is equal to zero? Let's take the previous example. So we add some constraint. For example, k is between 0 and 4. We suppose that the fault are between 0 and 2. And using this criterion, we can construct a table in which if you have a zero in a cell, it means that the algebraic signature always vanishes for this multifault. If it's not equal to zero, so we are certain that the algebraic signature never vanishes for this multifold. So here we can conclude that the two folds are discriminable because the lines are all different.
This is very confusing. This is numerical as well as algebraic.
Algebra.
Then, but you have numerics in there. K is a real number.
Yes, because I am on semi-algebraic tools, so I can add some constraints on parameters.
Oh,
on
I see.
Food, but so it's not. But if we.
So those tools, how efficient are they? Semi-algebraic tools?
Yes, they're very efficient. Yes.
Very efficient?
Yes. We use a function in MAPLE, but perhaps we can discuss afterwards.
Because basically you're doing cylindrical algebraic decomposition.
I guess so.
That's very similar.
Maybe it depends. So maybe the practical examples that go into this, maybe they are of the size that will be suitable.
Double exponential.
Right, it's in theory, and that's if the dimension grows. But maybe these particular examples that no, are considered here, maybe they're oversized. So I'm not sure.
Well, maybe they have structure, right? Because sort of it's kind of like the variables have a bit split, so maybe this also helps. I mean, there could be reasons for this sort of problems to result in better CAD than you would imagine.
CAD algorithms not.
Well, but in any case, you mentioned some worst case dependence on a particular parameter or some dimension. Maybe the worst case is not reached here. And maybe the dimension is fixed.
Okay.
When you tested this, did you take, did you use some examples from practice?
Yes.
So
the
right example
yes.
For practice for which
to see. It was for the talk that I took this simple example. But I have a more complex example afterwards.
But they still work with, but it doesn't take too much time.
Sometimes, but it is not the problem because this study is done before the conception of a system. So, in fact, it is not if you want to detect a fault that occurs in your system, so you need to have the information immediately if, for example, you are in a plane. But here, it is conceived, it is done before. So, finally, the time, yes, there is you must take it into account, but it is not.
It's not huge. So no. It's a few hours or a few days?
No, a few hours for a more complex system.
Okay. So maybe there are some domains in which the examples would result in larger computation. For what is being discussed here, the practical examples, they're actually. You know.
But the advantage of this method too is that you can use it to do detection and to have immediately the result on what is the multifault that occurs in your system. Only in evaluating the algebraic signature, since you can estimate phi 1, phi 2, and you know k and d. So it is a theoretical work that can be long, but it gives you some very interesting relation to put in practice. So what I didn't say here is that if you don't put some constraints on the fault on the parameters, the faults are not yet discriminable. When you have an empty cell, in fact, you don't know if it is always equal to zero or it is not equal to zero. So it is an ambiguous case here. For example, for the last line, perhaps here you can have a zero, but you don't know. So you cannot discriminate effectively the thing. So here's I've got the time, or it's finished.
There's
All right. So here's a model of a two-couple water tank. You have one over the other. The equation, so x1 is the height of the level in each tank, in the tank 1, x2 is the level in the tank 2. So they are described by the following equation, where u is the input, so it corresponds to the arrival of the water in the first water tank. And then y, that is the output what I can observe here, is the output of water of the first water tank. The water falls in the second water tank, And we suppose that we can have four faults here. So F1 on the input of your system, there is this function. F2 is at the output of my first water tank, so it is on Y. And then we suppose that we have a fault on F3 at the output of my second water tank. So when F3 is equal to 1, in fact, it is a fully clogged pipe situation. And if F3 is between 0 and 1, it's a partial clogging. So the problem here, when we want to use the Rosenfeld-Bondner algorithm, is the rules here. So the idea is to make a change of variable. So we put Z1 square equal to X1 and Z2 square equal to X2. So we can avoid the root here. We can now use the Rosenfeld-Grumner algorithm on the system, and we obtain an input-output relation here, which is more complex than the previous example. So I recall that the method consists in taking the exhaustive summary, the coefficient of the input-output polynomial with all the parameters, with no restriction. So we form the exhaustive summary, the vector in which you have the coefficients of your polynomials. And then we applied our algorithm in order to form an algebraic signature depending only on the value of your coefficient and the parameters vector. So our final algebraic signature is defined here. So phi 1 will be this expression. Phi 4 will be minus 2 F2, etc. Have you got some questions? No. So now, after using the criterion that we propose, we suppose that we have some restriction of the parameters P1, P5, and that F3, the third fault, is between 0 and 1. And we obtain this table. So finally, what we can say is that the second 4 and 5 algebraic signature permit to discriminate all the multifolds. So it is sufficient to consider only three components of our algebraic signature. You have always one expression which is different from these three vectors. So let's come to the conclusion. So the algebraic tools permit to make some quite fine identifiability, fog diagnosability, fog diagnosis to die, and to obtain very interesting results in aeronautics, for example. And so we can apply this notion in the context of Pandit-Debord uncertain models, so when we have uncertainties on the measurements. These algebra tools can be applied on the identifiability in a partial differential equations model. On the perspective, to develop identifiability in integral differential equation with François Boullier of Lille. And we are working too with Sébastien Orange on the identifiability and diagnosability in the case of networks. So, here
the papers in which you have more information of my talk.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Question. So you mentioned PDEs.
Yes.
There, do you consider parameters that depend on some space variables?
Yes. Yes. They depend on space. It's not really a restriction. The only thing that changes is the domain of the exhaustive. Definition domain of the exhaustive summary. So we must be careful when we study the exhaustive summary and the injectivity, in fact, of this function.
And how would this be related to the inverse problem for the PDEs? Inverse problem.
Yes.
What is the relation?
The relation?
What the question is. Is this the same as the inverse problem for PDEs that you're solving? Or you're solving something else?
No, I solve the same problems, but we must be careful because they have another definition of inverse problem. So I take the ODE version, but in fact, I must be careful with that. I must work on this subject.
Any questions?